Penguin Random House Audio presents The Girl's Guide to Hunting and Fishing, 25th Anniversary Edition, by Melissa Bank. Read for you by the author, with Helen Laser, with a foreword by Nick Hornby, read for you by John Lee. To my real-life girl guides, Adrienne Brodeur, Carol DeSanti, Carol Fiorino, Molly Friedrich, Judy Katz, and Anna Wingfield.
Foreword. I met Melissa Bank in the late 20th century, in between the publication of her two books. The one you are holding, let's pretend that it is the late 20th century and you have no choice but to hold a book in order to read it, and The Wonder Spot. I can't remember how or why we met, but for a while we hung out whenever I was in New York or she was in London. I loved spending time with her. She wanted to talk and to listen and to laugh as loudly and as frequently as possible. But she was acutely observant, shrewd, endlessly sympathetic and, above all, loving. It seemed to me that she met people hoping she could love them. And she was fearless. I had already read The Girl's Guide to Hunting and Fishing when we met. So, like everyone else, I was a fan. When I was putting together Speaking with the Angel, an anthology of short stories with contributions from Irvin Welsh and Dave Eggers and Zadie Smith and a whole bunch of other people, Melissa was someone whose work I very much wanted to include. She gave me The Wonder Spot, the story, not the book, and she came to London when Speaking with the Angel was launched. The launch party was an enormous event in the Hammersmith Palais, the much-loved gig venue, now gone, that The Clash sang about. Teenage Fan Club played, and well-known actors read a couple of stories to an excitable crowd. It was a tough gig, even for the actors, experienced professional show-offs, and only one of the authors wanted to read her own work to the noisy spectators, Melissa, the one who had only recently published her debut book. Everyone in that audience, many of whom had had more than one drink, listened to every word. She was a knockout. Reading interviews with Melissa now, all these years later, it's interesting and a little depressing to see how often she seemed to be required to defend herself. The introduction to one of them includes the line, "Certainly the pages turn without too much difficulty, however," as if this is somehow beside the point of reading, before the male interviewer asks the author whether she thinks chick lit is a demeaning term. "Let me help you out, Mr. Interviewer." Yes, it's a demeaning term. It usually means people are buying and reading and loving this book, and they are not buying and reading and loving mine, so they are cheating in some way. People who write about books used to worry a lot about whether a book was literature or not back then, weirdly. They worried especially if the book had jokes in it. The vast majority of readers didn't and still don't think about that at all. Melissa's retort, which was a good one, was this: "For me, a lot of the work comes in refining it. Even if I'm saying something that I think of as having real depth or substance, I don't want to say it in a way that bogs a reader down. I'm after something else." In other words, what often gets talked about as literature is simply a couple of drafts short of being something that people can consume with any pleasure. Melissa's way of creating literature was to write simple, plain sentences in many different colors and lay them next to each other until they formed a beautiful mosaic. And this mosaic was placed over a bed of melancholy that you are only dimly aware of when first the story and then the book are over. There's the complexity. There's the art and the depth. The Girl's Guide to Hunting and Fishing is about two decades in the life of a young woman, Jane Rosenau. This, of course, is asking for trouble, or at least asking for a snooty critic to dismiss it in patronizing terms while admitting at the same time that it's entertaining and funny. But Jane Rosenau is dealing with growing up. She's a teenager in the first story. Loneliness, a career that she may or may not be suitable for, inappropriate and unsatisfying sexual relationships, mortally ill parents, doubt, confusion. She's dealing with the stuff of life, in other words, the only life an ordinary young woman, or man, in a big city knows. And she thinks about it, and despairs over it, and makes jokes about it. This book is full of terrific one-liners, all of which deserve the compliment of being left where they belong, in the body of the book, so that you can enjoy them as they were meant to be enjoyed. When Melissa died, I posted a picture on Instagram of her and me and our friend, the writer Sarah Vowell. I want to quote a couple of the comments that people posted underneath. The first, from a publisher, said, "Girl's Guide to Hunting and Fishing changed my relationship to reading forever. I still think about it all the time." The other, from a writer, said, "The Wonder Spot is one of my all-time favorite novels. I keep it by my desk for inspiration and reread it every year." You could find similar sentiments all over the internet. Both of her beautiful books, I was happy and sad to see, meant a great deal to a whole generation of writers. I doubt that she understood that when she was alive, and she wouldn't have believed it anyway. She wasn't the type. I miss her, of course. Everyone who knew her misses her. But you will miss her too, if you are about to read this book for the first time. You will wish that there were 10 or 15 other books to catch up on. You will be sorry that we can't read about one of her characters coming to grips with cell phones, dating apps, gender identity, bitter political division, or any of the other 21st century material that Melissa would have written about so well. The Girl's Guide to Hunting and Fishing is nearly a quarter of a century old, and people go on discovering it, reading it, laughing at the jokes, and being moved by it, just as they do with I Capture the Castle, or the novels of Muriel Spark, or True Grit. Longevity is the only indicator of literature that really matters, and this book is built to last. Nick Hornby.
Advanced Beginners.
While home is the place where you can relax and be yourself, this doesn't mean that you can take advantage of the love and affection other members of your family have for you. From 20th Century Typewriting by D.D. Lessenberry, T. James Crawford, and Lawrence W. Erickson.
My brother's first serious girlfriend was 8 years older, 28 to his 20. Her name was Julia Cathcart, and Henry introduced her to us in early June. They drove from Manhattan down to our cottage in Loveladies on the New Jersey shore. When his little convertible, his pet, pulled into the driveway, she was behind the wheel. My mother and I were watching from the kitchen window. I said, "He lets her drive his car." My brother and his girlfriend were dressed alike, baggy white shirts tucked into jeans, except she had a black cashmere sweater over her shoulders. I thought maybe she'd look older than Henry, but it was Henry who looked older than Henry. Standing there, he looked like a man. He'd grown a beard, for starters, and had on new wire-rimmed sunglasses that made him appear more like a bon vivant than a philosophy major between colleges. His hair was longer and not yet lightened by the sun. It was the reddish-brown color of an Irish setter. He gave me a kiss on the cheek as though he always had. Then he roughed around with our Airedale, Atlas, while his girlfriend and mother shook hands. They were clasping fingertips, ladylike, smiling as though they were already fond of each other and just waiting for details to fill in why. Julia turned to me and said, "You must be Janie." "Most people call me Jane now," I said, making myself sound even younger. "Jane," she said, possibly in the manner of an adult trying to take a child seriously. Henry unpacked the car and loaded himself up with everything they'd brought. Little bags and big ones, a string tote and a knapsack. As he started up the driveway, his girlfriend said, "Do you have the wine, Hank?" Whoever Hank was, he had it. Except for bedrooms and the screened-in porch, our house was just one big all-purpose room, and Henry was giving her a jokey tour of it. "This is the living room," he said, gesturing to the sofa. He paused, gestured to it again, and said, "This is the den." Out on the porch, she stretched her legs in front of her, Audrey Hepburn relaxing after dance class. She wore navy espadrilles. I noticed that Henry had on penny loafers without socks, and he'd inserted a subway token in the slot where the penny belonged. Julia sipped her iced tea and asked how Loveladies got its name. We didn't know, but Henry said it was derived from the Indian name of the founder.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.